Hello everyone and welcome again. Nice that you're watching. We are facing a situation that we want to overview and structure as a first step to deal with the complexity. For this, we use stakeholder perspective, we develop criteria and identify a short list of promising changes or system interventions that should change our situation in a direction that we want. Initially, people tend to focus at one particular idea that they want to implement. For instance, one particular way to reduce sick leave in a company. As soon as you use stakeholder perspectives and enrich your own picture of the complex situation, suddenly lots and lots of other ideas also pop up. Not all of them are good ideas, so you use a few screening criteria to shorten your long list of ideas to a short list of very promising ideas. You expect that among these promising ideas, there are a few very good ones. Now what you want is to make a good comparison so it becomes easier to choose. Ideally, you would like to compare each idea for a change in an explicit way so you can more easily make a better decision. For complex situations, many times decisions are taken in groups. And if not, still chances are that for the implementation of that idea, you need a lot of other people. So an explicit overview showing the comparison between a few promising ideas is very valuable input for the decision-making process. Because then it is for everyone to see what the effect of a certain decision will be. Decision-making itself is quite a difficult, unpredictable process in which many factors play a role. It can take long and for sure people will almost always disagree. This decision-making process takes a lot of energy also. The contribution of a systematic analytical approach, as we apply it here, is that at least during this decision-making process, there are no arguments anymore about particular effects of certain ideas. So time and energy is saved for the rest of the decision-making process. What we do is actually quite simple. We draw a table, put all the ideas for change in a column, and the decision-making criteria we derived from the goal hierarchies each in a row. Now we have to estimate the effects of the implementation of each idea for each criterion. And we have to make that estimate for each scenario we consider, as every change we implement most likely will have a slightly different effect in a different future. As you see the overview, you can immediately understand why it is so important to keep the number of criteria and the number of scenarios low. It needs to become an overview that you can easily oversee, otherwise it's useless. The situations we face are many times new, so are the system interventions. In many cases, no detailed information is available about the effects of our system interventions. If you are lucky, you may find something in the literature, or you find someone with experience who is willing to share it with you. But many times, however, everything is new and you have to find it out yourself. As real-life tests and pilot implementations are very costly and time-consuming, many times you will have to make estimates of the effects of your promising system interventions. Now let me focus a bit more on making these estimates. You can estimate them in several ways. One is to use the power of a group and together make educated guesses. Most of the time people use scores in a range, for instance 1 to 5, where 1 is the worst and 5 is best. You can also use pluses and minuses, but that's very comparable, as many people use ranges like double minus, single minus, zero, plus, and double plus, representing a range of 1 to 5, basically. You will be surprised, however, how well even a small group of people that is really open can estimate the effects of certain changes. You can also make these estimates yourself, of course, however, chances are smaller that you are accurate. There's also a way to come up to numerical results. What you do here is that you break down the effect of that what you want to estimate in smaller factors until for every factor you can make a numerical estimate that is order of magnitude accurate. For example, if you are a railway company and plan to ride 10 trains every hour between 5 in the morning and midnight and quickly need to estimate the daily capacity, just break down this capacity. Every train has 10 wagons. Every wagon has around 50 seats, and there is still enough room for another 50 people to stand. So the capacity of 10 trains during 90 hours of operation with 10 wagons is 95,000 sitting and 95,000 standing passengers. So roughly 200,000 for a total operating day. Things like this help a lot, as many times you are in a hurry or in a discussion and have to come up with numbers quickly. Of course, if you have time, you look up things in the internet or in your files, but if you don't have that time, this estimate method is very valuable. Practice it a few times and you will see how useful it is in your daily working life. After giving all this new information a bit more thought in the quiz of this week, try and apply it to your case and see what it brings you. Good luck, enjoy it, and I see you in another video.